Welcome to another episode of Harbor Rock Wealth Management's podcast series, Life, Health, and Wealth, where we discuss financially driven topics and how they relate to our financial lifestyles. He's Reuben Smith. I'm Jimmy Lester. And today we have Matt Moore from New American Funding.
Hi.
The Lord of Lending, I like to call you.
Lending.
Wow. I love that.
The Lord of Lending. Lending wizard.
Wow. Can I use that? The Lord of Lending?
It's not on your card yet?
No, it should be.
It's yours.
It will be by tomorrow.
Local legend. However you want to play it.
I like the Lord of, I don't know how that's going to go over, Lord of Lending.
It's like, I take it from like Jerry Maguire, the Lord of the Living Room.
Oh.
So when we were getting ready for the show today, I'm all, alliteration, Lord of Lending.
Oh my God.
So here we are.
I love it. Well, I love it.
Thanks for taking some time to be here.
But you know what I really do think?
Yes.
Real quick, is I call myself the Mortgage Maestro. So
I like that.
But I like that better.
I like that.
All right.
The Mortgage Maestro.
We'll workshop it.
Use it as you'd like. But thank you for joining us. It's been a long time since you and I have actually connected in person.
It really has. I was thinking about it as I walked in, Reuben, and it's got to be over 20 years.
I can safely say that we've both aged well.
Yeah, you better than me, because you look exactly the same.
Oh, well, thank you.
You really do. Look exactly the same.
One thing I know about Matt is that he's always got a good sense of humor, and I can't quite tell if you're being honest with that one or not, but I'll take it.
No, so. I'm serious. I'm dead serious.
So it feels genuine.
So I've been I've been back in town. I say back in town, working in town for call it 10 years, and whether it's through social media or just kind of seeing or hearing that. What's going on? You've been in the mortgage business and you followed your family for three decades now, or three generations, excuse me.
Three generations, yeah. I actually, were you finished? I'm sorry.
Well, yeah, I was going to say, I thought you'd be an intriguing guest to come in. Not only do I want to connect with you personally again, but one thing that we're trying to build here in San Clemente is that community feel and stay connected.
Yeah.
And considering we graduated together, we're probably on the same retirement path as far as time frame, and so I'm happy you're here, man.
Thank you. Yeah. And I appreciate you inviting me as well. I'd say that as far as lenders go, we're probably the most based in San Clemente lender team,
right?
Because it's third generation. My grandpa was a lender, my father was a lender, and then myself and my two brothers are lenders.
Right.
Right. And then where we work is on Del Mar.
In the heart.
literally in the heart of Del Mar. So that obviously works out really well. A lot of our clients will come in and see us.
Right.
So,
what a concept, doing business in person.
I know, right? Because during COVID, it was so foreign to me, at least, that everything was Zoom, and I don't do as well with that.
Yeah.
I really like to see my client face to face and tell them what I can do.
Well, it's the biggest financial decision that we make typically is buying a home.
You took the words literally right out of my mouth.
I mean, that's a personal experience.
I literally tell my client.
It's important.
I literally say, you're not buying a car. You're not buying a washing machine. You can't take it back.
That's right.
You're buying a house.
Yeah.
It's that big. You'll never buy anything bigger. You might buy a bigger house, but it's your biggest investment, just like you were saying.
Totally.
So.
Yeah, most people only do it a couple times in their life, maybe even once.
Maybe once, if you're lucky.
My family had, a few different homes. I'm the youngest of four siblings, 10, 16, and 17 years older than me.
Oh, wow.
When I was growing up. So they had a history. They had chapters before my life. Mm-hmm. I was later in the book. And the house that I grew up in, my dad's still there.
Amazing.
I mean, in San Juan, and that was really cool.
I mean, I'll be honest with you, it's probably not good for my business for someone to do that.
Sure.
Because you're don't get a lot
of
loans.
Sure, of course, yeah.
I think that's the American dream, is just to buy the house, raise your family, pay the mortgage off.
Yeah, I say.
And just live there.
What did I tease Dad? I'm all, Dad, you bought that for a box of raspberries.
Yeah, dude. Exactly. And it's probably worth a couple million now, or whatever it's worth.
It's incredible. They're on a green belt. Who knows what a green belt is?
Exactly.
It's pretty cool. Well,
it's so cool though. Yeah.
Being a local business owner, we joined those ranks a year and a half ago. And it's.
Oh, congrats.
And now, we worked with a lot of business owners for a long time, and we were involved in the community to some extent. But now it's such an honor to be part of that club. You know, it's like, wow, we've made it.
And it's a little different, right? Even it though, is. Like, you did probably work with people in San Clemente, for whatever reason, it's different actually being in San Clemente.
Well, when you have the autonomy to call your own shots, if you will, or support the organizations that you want to mm-hmm. without getting approval from anyone else, I mean, that's really it. I mean,
would you say that's the biggest change, going from, like, a big institution, right? Well, to your own thing.
Yeah. So one of the things that changed for us was the nothing against the former company, but it was the business model was changing. Mm-hmm. We were being asked to do things that were actually taking away from where we thought we brought value. So we did as well as we could under that business model to kind of create our own mini business, if you will.
Yeah.
But, you know, the writing was on the wall, and what we craved was our ability to be authentic and genuine with our clients.
Yourself.
And really partner with clients.
Absolutely.
We quickly realized that we had more in common with our clients than we thought. Just because we weren't at retirement age, which is a lot of our clients are pre-retirees, retirees, and we are planning to...
So you're like, we don't have anything in common with them.
Well, you know, it's like sometimes people think of like, or they've had an advisor... client relationship to where they get told what to do and then they go apply that.
Very one-sided.
That's very not what we do, being transparent and vulnerable in our process. We've really jumped into it. We walk miles in our clients' shoes. I'm all, take them off. We're going to take a couple laps and we're going to really feel like what it's like to be you.
Totally.
And we would never ask you to do anything that we wouldn't do or I'd help my mom or my dad with or... So it's been very fulfilling in that sense, and I'm sure you got to feel some of that, too.
I'm really happy that you guys invited me in, and I'll tell you why. It's because one of the things that I live by is, and my dad told me this when I first got into the business. He's like, I can't teach you everything day one, but what I can tell you is it's not rocket science, A, but more importantly, you treat your client's money like it's your own money.
Right.
And you'll never have a hard decision in this business ever.
Right.
Just treat it like it's yours.
Right.
What would you do with it?
Yeah.
And that's really got me by so good. Like, we're like, there are decisions to make.
Sure.
Like, should we do this or that? And then I'll just reflect. I'm like, well, if it were me, this is what I would do.
Yeah.
So I always have a clean conscience.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah.
And honestly, that's literally worth its weight in gold. Cause like,
no, it's good advice. Talk about stripping it back simple to its core.
Just simple.
Well, I think in both of our careers, you know, we're both in finance, but we're in different parts of it or segments of it. It can be very easy to talk over the client's head, mm-hmm. right? And talk to them about what they need to do without really educating them or asking them, you know, fully understanding where they're at and whether it's structuring a loan or building a financial plan, building out a portfolio. So, if you can get down to, I don't want to say their level, but really speak to their level to where mm-hmm. they fully grasp and understand whatever recommendation it is that you're putting in front of them, now they are well equipped to make that decision, whether it's a fit or not. And if it's not, okay, we're back to the drawing board.
Exactly.
Well, it's like being less authoritarian and more consultative. Like,
I love how you said that.
Like, get over yourself. If you can get over yourself, but there's a lot of egos in our businesses.
I know.
And I think we've all experienced it on one end of the desk mm-hmm. or the other. And as soon as you can just do good work and do it the right way, all the other stuff takes care of itself.
I don't know how you said that. I'm gonna have to ask you after.
You'll have to watch this. You'll have to watch
it. No, because I tell my clients, we'll send you the link. Exactly. because I tell my clients the same thing. I'm like, look, I'm less salesman, more teacher.
Totally. So
when you come in, I want to teach you about, especially first-time homebuyers, I want to teach you about the process. I want to teach you what to look out for.
Totally.
But I'm not going to sell you on anything. I want you to know what you want, and you tell me, not vice versa.
Yeah, if it's a fit, let's roll. If not,
exactly.
It's not, it sounds a lot better sometimes. Yeah. Well,
you trust in the process, and the rest of the financials will take care of itself.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So I was in the mortgage industry myself.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Interesting.
In a time I just missed the crazy boom in like early to mid
2000s. Oh, dang.
I got in I didn't even know what amortization meant.
Exactly.
I was playing baseball and I was playing semi-professional baseball.
Really?
And then moved back into town from after college and everything. And I needed a job. And I got a job at Lowe's, actually. And if you know anything about me, you don't know this. I'm color deficient. I'm colorblind.
Yeah.
I can't pass the little color test and everything. Well, what was I doing? I was the paint manager at Lowe's for 3 years. Oh, no. And I did a damn good job.
Did you really?
I did. I was mixing paint.
You
I
crushed
was,
it. It's a computer.
The machines do a good job, you know? But
that's amazing, so by
I,
the way.
I did though. That for a few years, and I was lucky to have that job, and I learned a lot there. I was in my early mid-20s, and I was managing 8 or 10 people, managing about $3 million of inventory. I learned a lot, and I thank Lowe's for that opportunity. Then my buddy Brandon got into the mortgage industry, and he's like, and it was starting to pop.
And he's like,
Jimmy, I know your personality. I think you would kill it. Like, you need to get out of Lowe's. This is a career move. Career move. Mm. Well, I did. I left Lowe's.
Killed it, probably.
I sunsetted. I paid the bills. I learned a lot. I remember, I want to share this with you, and you'll appreciate this. My first mortgage job was at a small shop on Von Karman. You know, in
everyone
Irvine,
was on Von
everyone
Carman.
Worked on Von Karman at one point. It's like the Wall Street of mortgages.
I'm just picturing a boiler room kind of thing. Like,
well,
a big pit.
It was a small shop. There was a few brokers. There was a couple mortgage officers, and I was a junior, and I had no experience. But Ray, the main guy, he liked me, and he put me at a desk facing a wall with no window, and I had a stack of title leads from 1994, and a yellow legal pad, a pencil, no computer, just a phone, and he said, I want you to go through these, and most of these people don't live there anymore, and they're probably going to say some mean things to you, but I want you to call
some
these
of them
people,
were dead, even.
Yeah, and I want you to get these people excited to talk to one of our senior loan officers and see what the opportunity is, and if you get 30 of these, I'll let you come out as a junior on your own, you know. And so I did. In those first 2 weeks, I've shared this story. My gastro system wasn't quite working very well because I was so nervous. And I was like, I made a mistake. I need to go back and mix paint, you know. So anyway, but I started to make it. And you know what I learned? Some skills that came, they probably still are with you, talking on the phone. That's a lost art.
Sure.
You know, being resilient. Wow. It's not personal. Just keep going, get
phone.
A process. All these things that I learned, and I totally attribute that to being in the mortgage industry. I met some of the most talented people on my few stops throughout
crazy.
That I still
crazy
look at the most talented salespeople. When I say sales, I mean in a good way. I mean their skill level was off the chart.
It is an art.
They were resilient. They made it through so many ups and downs and turbulence.
Very similar, all of them.
I got laid off twice in 1 year, and my wife at the time said, who was a teacher, she said she didn't understand that. She thought we were all lucky in what we did. And she said, if you do this, if you get another job in the mortgage industry, like, it's over, man.
because it was tough.
So it was a tough time. I just missed the big boom. But I really owe a lot of where I am today and how I talk to people, listen, treat people, understand the processes to my experience there. And I wanted to share that with you because your family's been in it a long time, and I'm sure a lot of that resonated with you. You know,
yeah, so. No, it definitely does. Like, without any shadow of a doubt. Like, it totally does.
Sure.
It's so funny. Yeah, it's like mortgage people, they're a different breed, though.
It's a
like,
different environment.
Like, if you put me in a room, I'd be like, mortgage guy, mortgage
totally.
Guy.
You can pick them out, right?
Oh, yeah.
It's a small world, too. We kind of, you know, I remember guys like, oh, yeah, he was over at B of A, and he was running his own shop over here.
And everybody, like.
He ran a team at WAMU and, like, all these, yeah.
Exactly. Yeah, it's very small.
So it also seems like a profession where it gets hot and cold, right? Let's call it that.
Dude, big time.
And so you have,
especially recently,
you have a lot of guys coming from Lowe's to join, to jump on and maybe make some money.
Yep.
Not to poke fun.
No, not at
all.
But
you have some real new raw people getting into the business, and maybe they're doing good work. I don't know. But then you have teams like yours that have been vetted and stand the test of time.
Yeah.
And so what do you think you attribute that to? Is it?
It's just when the good times per se are really when the rates go down. And so all these companies, you get all these refi shops opening up.
Sure.
And so when these refi shops open up, that's when you get the people from wherever, Lowe's, let's just say, and they go work for a refi shop, right?
I remember there was a kid working at Petco, and in the first...
Because you just need someone to...
2 weeks earlier, he was working at Petco selling fish, and then he was making 15 grand a month.
Exactly.
And no offense to him.
You just need someone to pick up the phone.
But I remember, yeah, he's consulting people on the biggest financial decision they're going to make. It was kind of scary. And
it is.
I have a couple, but not to, sorry to interrupt you there,
no,
but there's
not.
A couple buddies that I still have in the industry that have done good work from the beginning when I first met them. They're still there and they probably should still be there. And I think that's what you were alluding to.
And I think that's what it is, right?
You like, should be there.
Yeah. Right? Like, see, we've always concentrated our business, not on refis, but on relationships rather. So like relationships with realtors, that's where we get most of our business from.
Mm-hmm.
And even when everyone was doing all the refis, we did refis, sure, but we still concentrated on our agents and gave them top service so that when rates went up, which they did, we still had the business coming in from there.
Yep.
That allowed us to sustain.
Sure, sure. And there's, you know, being a broker versus working for, say, one of the large banks out there, you have a lot more flexibility when it comes to customizing the loan, right?
Yep.
And you have options. I know who we worked for before. They had a niche, and they had a specific loan and a specific client that they would be very favorable for. But for the masses, or for some, let's say, they were just not interested in participating.
Yeah, like if someone walks into my office and they want a loan, it's very uncommon that I send them packing without a loan.
Okay.
So it's just that we have so many different types of loans, from bank statement loans to stated loans to home equity lines of credit, jumbo.
Are those programs back?
Yeah.
And have they been adjusted a little bit to be a little more sound? And
with the stated income?
Yeah, they don't leak, you know?
Mm-mm.
Yeah, yeah.
They don't
leak. Well, that's good.
Because those,
that's
yeah, but that's great because
the biggest thing, though, if you think about it, is just real simple. A higher down payment, you can't do 100% stated. And that was the problem, right?
Totally,
like,
totally.
No money. Because if they're putting 40%
down. You need some
down,
skin in the game.
They've got the skin in the game. Yeah. So, like, it's.
They're vetted.
Exactly.
Yeah, they're vested.
I would
they're
say
vetted.
That's the biggest thing. And then obviously seeing their bank statements and seeing that they actually have real money coming in.
It makes sense.
It makes sense underwriting is what it is.
Yeah, would if I was an investor, would I invest in this loan?
Yeah, exactly. And that's really what it comes down to.
Yeah.
I think if I'm putting myself in the consumer shoes, which I've bought in a few houses over the years, so I've been through that experience, you don't know what you don't know. And so if you walk into your bank or... let's say you go into your bank and they give you a rate and you assume, well, that's the rate.
Exactly.
Okay, let's go. Well, the advantage of working with a broker is that maybe that bank doesn't necessarily want to participate in that field or that loan size. So having a broker going out there, quote unquote, to shop it for you.
Like, okay, like who has the lowest rate for this scenario?
Totally.
Who's got the lowest rate for that scenario? So, I mean, it really does. And plus... I'm a direct lender, it's called.
Oh, you are.
Meaning that I don't have to charge broker fees. So the cost to get a loan through me is the same as getting a loan through one of the bigger institutions.
I got you.
It's the same exact cost.
That's wonderful.
Well, I think...
Because, you know, like you think of broker fees.
Yeah,
sure.
There's no broker fees. So
I got you.
That's the difference.
Yeah.
So the other thing is, as this world becomes more instantaneous and easy to access. So you can go online and you can get life insurance, you can buy an investment, you can get a home loan.
It's so crazy.
You can buy a car online and have it delivered to your house without meeting someone.
So, and going back to where you bring value and that personal touch and your preference as far as how to meet with clients, I think that's exactly why we will always have a career. We'll always have a job because finances can be debilitating. And if for some people that really know what they're doing, going online, and if they find that right loan, more power to them. But it can be debilitating, and having
especially
that education and that
purchase,
advocate.
Right? Like, I have so many, not so many, I have clients that, they're trying, you know, they're very sophisticated. They're very smart individuals. And, you know, they're like, just go online and do it that way on a purchase. Never ends well.
No.
They always end up calling me.
That's like,
talk about
emotional.
I know
that experience.
Because like they even believe it or not, even the ones that like have the confidence, they've done it before, they still need a little hand holding because like
totally.
And they want me to like handle the realtor. You know, it just, that's what they're paying for. It's like, not just to get the loan, but like handle everything else.
Take too. Some of this off my,
off the plate, yeah, right? Because absolutely. They got to pack, they got to work their real job. They have so much going on. So it's more than just like a rate, right? Because that's all we hear about. It's like, but with mortgages, right? It's like, what rate did you get?
Right.
I wish they like more times they would be like, well, how was the service?
Right.
For some
right.
reason, that's not asked. Do you know what I mean?
It's dollars and cents, my exactly. friend. Unfortunately.
Totally.
So, yeah. So, one thing that we like to, how we like to position ourselves with clients is to be kind of the general practitioner, right? People, mm-hmm. clients come to us and say, hey, I want to buy a house, or hey, I want to retire, I want to,
yeah.
whatever. And then we're building up a network of trusted contacts where we, because we don't do home loans, we don't do trust work, we don't do yeah. taxes, but we're building up this network of partnering. And how I position ourselves is the client is the focal point always. And around them, their team is going to be a CPA, is going to be a financial advisor. It's yep. going to be Harbor Rock Wealth Management. It's going to be whatever it is that you need in your life, you're going to have this team. And it sounds like you're doing essentially the same thing. You're the lending component of it. You're yep. financing. You're working with their realtor, mm-hmm. right? And so you're also taking that.
Same
and,
exact
and
thing.
The whole point same is to make this thing. As streamlined as possible yep. for them, a better experience as a whole.
Exactly.
So anytime that you can have these professionals advocating and working for you, it's a win.
And you nailed it. You're very like insightful because like when a realtor refers me a deal, it's not like, hey, I'm referring it to Matt. It's like, hey, Matt's on my team. I'm not.
This is an extension.
But I am an extension in the team. Matt's on my team. We do a lot of deals together.
Sure.
And he'll take great care of you.
Right.
You know, so you just hit the nail on the head, really.
I love it.
Well, it's kind of like, you know, with our clients, the plan as a whole, you know, we're almost like their CFO at that
yeah,
point. Kind of exactly. like kind of mm-hmm. like that soundboard. And a big part of the plan is the lending piece. So we're often, you know, we don't do that. We're not an attorney, like Ruben was saying. We don't do Medicare. But we do plan for all these kind of things. So
sure,
you know that.
And I think it's the best thing for like for guys like you to say, I only want to do what I do best because I think that's what
like stay in your lane.
Dude, stay yeah, in your lane because totally. I think that's what benefits the clients the most.
Well,
look, maybe I can make money doing other stuff yeah, and like do yeah. that on the side. But no, I'd rather the person that's a professional help my client
right.
so they get the best experience.
Well, and not overstepping, you know, overstepping your boundaries, if you will. With our licenses, we could be on the floor of Wall Street. Right. We could be trading
making
stocks.
Funny hand signals.
We could be trading pork bellies.
Yeah, yeah, yeah,
but
yeah.
we don't want to trade pork bellies.
No, exactly.
We want to build relationships with clients that value our advice, and we will guide them from point A to point B, whatever that goal is.
And I think right. what it does is what we all are looking for is we want to create clients for life and raving fans.
Boom.
So that if anyone even mentions, you know, wealth management at a party, they're like, they like us so much that they're like, oh, dude.
They're rooting for you.
Call
yes.
Ruben
yes.
tomorrow.
Right.
Do you know what I mean? You like, because, and I tell my clients this, like, look, the reason you know I can't retire on your loan.
Exactly.
So what I need is I'm going to send you business cards when we close. I'm going to ask if you could just tell anyone if you've had a good experience
yeah.
to call me if they're in the same situation you are. And that's basically like, yeah, I probably say it a little better than that. But anyways,
yeah,
that's the gist of it.
Well, what happens is you start getting fans, right?
Yes.
These raving fans, like you mentioned, and they're interested in your success.
They are.
They want you to be
Dude,
successful.
Exactly. Exactly. And if you've done that, right. you're doing it right, right? Because like it's totally exactly what you want. Because yeah. if they're interested in your success, it's like
Now, okay, so let's. I'm going to play devil's advocate.
Yeah.
If I'm going in and to get a loan and someone's just firing bullets over me and that I don't understand what they're saying and
yeah.
they're talking way over my head, there's also an intimidation factor there where you're like, oh, well, it sounds professional. It sounds good. And I guess this is good and I'm going to sign and we're off we go. But what value did you really get?
Exactly.
Well, you pretty much just guaranteed that was a one-time transaction.
Are you? Is that person gonna? Am I gonna refer after that?
See, and that's the thing that you don't want. Totally. And I know people in this business.
Yeah, they churn and burn, man.
Dude, and yeah. All they try to do is
it's like, volume.
If the deal is not, it's exactly. I used to work with this guy, and he was a total one transaction, right? Because he did a lot of business, but he had no repeat business. Because if something was going south, he would tell me, he's like, Matt, I'll just bulldoze them. They'll take it. I'm like, dude.
Yeah.
But you want them to take what they want. Yeah. And he would try to tell me why it doesn't matter. I'm like,
well, it's a, yeah, it's a.
It's like, you know what? Two different ways.
Same thing. I've seen advisors that run a transactional business.
Yeah.
And really, you know, they're their best friends up until the point that it's funded or that the sale is complete.
Yep.
And then they're ghosted. You will never hear from that person again. Yeah. It's too bad.
You know, it's like with me, it's like, and especially being in San Clemente, I'll see my clients at soccer.
Oh, sure.
And I'll remember them. And I genuinely like them. Yeah. You know what I mean?
You're
like,
fulfilled by that?
Yes.
Yes, right?
Absolutely.
Well, that is something that we have experience with, too. Joining or opening Harbor Rock. At one point, we had 380 households under our name. And that's a lot of households.
It's almost too many.
It's impossible to do a good job servicing them.
You can't deliver on your promise. Yeah.
So we had some discernment, yeah, to come when the day we opened our doors, we sat at the table and jotted down every name that we could think of in a time where we just resigned and opened doors.
It's like a Jerry Maguire moment almost.
Think about everything right? That's going through your head. If the people we wrote down made the cut, so to speak, then we didn't have to identify specifically why they were impactful to us, but they were. Mm-hmm. So that is how.
And do you still have most of them?
Yeah.
We were lucky we were lucky to have so many that wanted to engage us and
that were fans
trusted us.
Well, relationship was already established.
It was a major validation for us that we had been doing things the right way for years.
Right?
Yeah, you don't know exactly who's coming. There was people that loved us that said, look, change.
Because some people hate
change.
Any change
is scary.
Even good change. Yep.
And some people had to get their head around, like, they hear the word independent. They hear, it's scary.
I've been with Chase for
so
long.
The big,
you know what I mean?
It's sure, like, the big blue octagon, you know? It's,
yeah.
And there's
yeah.
a lot of comfort in that. So, yeah, we were very lucky to be able to, A, make connections quickly with a lot of people that we still wanted to do business with. It was very intentional.
Because it does make your life a lot better, too, because, like, you enjoy going to work and dealing with your friends.
We just did a recent show, Ruben and I, a little year in review, and we talked about the first thing we talked about. We dropped it on the clients. We said, you better take your seats, everyone, because we have a big announcement. He said, we're retired from corporate life. And it was good. And you know, when our clients retire, it does take an adjustment. There's an adjustment time.
Yeah.
It takes some people years to really settle in and find worth again, and they're not doing the grind.
Now, are you guys still building?
So we have capacity, and that's something actually we really focus on is every client of ours has a customized service model, meaning they will have meetings with us as often as they want, monthly through annual.
Gosh, I love that.
And in the format that they want, in person, Zoom, phone, whatever. And so their service model is customized to them. What that allows us to do is look at a calendar and look at when our scheduled reviews are and say, oh, this is the capacity we have.
Yes.
So the last thing we want to do is diminish the experience from those clients that came over that were really the foundation of Harbor Rock.
I love the way you guys operate. I really do.
It's
very intentional, put it that way. It's this has been thought out and we are running it.
It's funny, right? You run it as a business. It's not rocket science. It's like,
I think the differentiator though is that we're running it in partnership with our clients. So for instance, on this show that we recorded the other day, we were very transparent. We added 12 households last year. That may not seem like a lot.
Most people would be like,
but that's perfect.
Yeah, they're all, you guys okay? Perfect. You need more than that? Like, how are you eating? You're looking a little thin. You know, you're like, dude, We're fine.
You enjoying that top ramen?
We're fine. Yeah, yeah. Right? Oh, Rice-A-Roni again.
Exactly. You know, it's like, oh, man, don't diss Rice-A-Roni.
I love it. I love it. San Francisco treat.
Oh, God.
Hey, life is good, man. We are fulfilled. Sounds like you are fulfilled.
I am.
In your life.
And, I am. I want to do more of this, though, with you as far as, like, exchanging clients and stuff, because I'm very protective, like you guys are, with my clients and who I refer them to. Because, as you know, it reflects on you.
Right, right.
And what's the easiest thing to get is a good reputation, but it's also the easiest thing to lose.
Yeah. Sure.
Right? So one bad referral, and that client's gone for life.
For sure.
So what that reminds me of, Matt, is how we refer out as well. We see every referral or everyone on this trusted contact list that we're developing as an extension of us. So we take our referrals very serious. We want feedback too. You know, if the experience wasn't well, then we need to know that because, again, that's an extension of us.
Now, do you guys say you referred me a deal?
Mm-hmm.
Would you follow up after the deal's done with like a survey or something like that?
We are in connection with our clients enough that I don't think there needs to be a formal survey, if you will.
Yeah, I don't know why I threw out survey. I was thinking just like maybe a phone call or something.
We certainly inquire whether it's with and you know face to face with one of our regular reviews. Hey, how'd it go?
It's great.
Small town gets smaller.
Yeah,
everyone. That's the beauty of this. And exactly. There's a little bit of accountability.
I just like you guys.
No, and there's just great people. I mean, we were just talking on a recent show that who knows? St. Clemente is the kind of town that you might be living next door to a former NFL player. Or a major league pitcher.
Olympian.
You know, but we're not starstruck here. We walk the beach trail together. We're all on the same page.
I will There's go just a good as heartbeat far here. As saying, like, San Clemente is, if not the best, like, one of the best cities/towns in America.
Oh, absolutely.
I mean, honestly, I truly believe that bottom of my heart.
Yeah, yeah. If
it wasn't
lot of
for
great,
the taxes, I would say it is for sure.
A lot of great cities out there, you know, across the country.
And I like a lot of them, right? It's not a diss on the other ones. And not maybe. I'm biased. This is where I live.
It sounds like you also realize how fortunate you are, too.
I am, right? Yeah.
I mean, we are so grateful.
Like my dad used to say, he's like, I'm just happy my ancestors went west and not east.
Yeah.
I love it.
Do you know what I mean, though?
Yeah,
well, absolutely. In our excitement to get started today, we diverted my fun fact of the day.
I was going to say this might be empty if we don't have a Jimmyism.
And I think
I want one.
I know. Well, I got a couple.
I have to do this again if I don't.
No,
get one.
I got a couple.
He's getting one. Let's see.
No, it's just quick. It's quick, and it's a good time to kind of wrap here. And this isn't going to be your last time. First time on the show, not the last
time. First time.
We'd like you actually to update us on what's going on in the market from time to time in the mortgage industry. What's changing? What's on the horizon?
Side note.
Yeah.
From my house to here, 7 minutes. So okay, now that I know where it's at.
Did you jump on a skateboard down here in your suit?
Honestly, I could.
Down the hill?
I could. I live in Forrester, so like.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're my right. Address is. No, I'm just kidding.
Yeah. You can find me at 123 Sycamore Lane. Yeah.
I love it.
So, first off, Australia is wider than the moon.
That's not true.
Yeah, it is true.
It can't be.
It is. Isn't that crazy?
Get out of here.
Australia is
wider.
Australia is wider than the moon.
Whiter?
Whiter. Whiter. Whiter.
I know, I'm just kidding.
Yeah. Whiter? Yeah. I don't know. The moon's pretty bright.
I know. No, but that's crazy.
I don't know. I just read that a minute ago, and I got to share that with everybody.
I always thought Australia was so small, but like.
No, it's wider than the moon.
It's big.
And also today is National Throw Your Leftovers Away Day. So that makes sense.
Is it really?
Yeah, it is.
All right.
Wait, time out.
Sorry,
time
Kelly.
Out.
That turkey's going out.
Time out. People still have leftovers from Thanksgiving?
Well,
we probably have some in there.
I think I have some.
That was a week ago.
I think I have some ambrosia in the back of the fridge.
Oh, do not.
It already.
No, it ages well.
Yeah.
It ages well.
Yeah. Well, you know.
Yeah. When the bananas
I'm not usually a fan
brown,
of my mother. Yeah.
They're good.
Well, my mother-in-law made this one. And actually, I'm not usually a fan. And
she's ambrosia.
A ripping cook, and she prepared a
good?
Really good one. Yes.
You know what it is for me?
It was good.
It's the coconut. It just throws
totally.
Me off.
Totally. No, this one was good. I definitely had a nice scoop.
What is your favorite sink?
Okay.
I know we're going back.
No, it's okay. It's okay.
What is your favorite
like my
Thanksgiving
favorite
dish?
So,
to me, it's a no-brainer, but.
So I'm a stuffing guy. Like, and my sister did.
You and I are like, dude.
Yeah.
We're spot on.
Jill's, my wife's green bean casserole. I know that's usually kind of one that people.
Are we related?
So that she makes a really good one.
Is it your standard? I'm not kidding. Is it your standard cream of
mushroom? No, we use garlic cream of mushroom soup, bacon. We did some oven, like hotel style bacon.
So I didn't get the invite.
This year. We didn't this year. We did it pretty normal this year, but stuffing is by far my number one.
My sister made one with sausage and all.
No, it's got to be. And the sausage makes it.
It was.
It has to be.
It's got to be savory.
Like a fresh and it's got to be. I like it a little wet. I don't like it when it gets super dry.
Same.
Yeah.
I like it when I can kind of almost mash it together.
Exactly. Do you like the? I know I got to get my hands.
No, this is good.
You like
the green bean casserole? I know a lot of people don't.
No, I do.
Yeah. My brother made some Ina Garten. Garlic mash.
Oh my god!
And you're still alive?
No, we had my brother-in-law made the best pecan. Chris made the best pecan pie in the planet. He makes it every year with a bourbon whip,
I'm homemade bourbon whip. I could barely fit. Lunchtime? I could barely.
Oh no! This does not button.
You still got the Thanksgiving.
But I can put my pants on.
I had to do two Thanksgivings too on two different days. I had to do a Saturday. And then the Saturday before, and then I did the Thursday. So like
I did it reverse. I went Thursday to Saturday.
Oh.
So I only had one day in between, and I think I jammed down a burrito Friday. So I had to keep the stomach.
Mix it.
What kind of burrito?
Probably
a turkey burrito, like
machaca or something.
No, he had to mix. He had to confuse the stomach.
Exactly, shock the. No, but I will say, Thanksgiving is so awesome.
Yeah,
I think it's my favorite holiday.
Yeah, and it's the season. We're in the season of being, of having gratitude.
Right? Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah, I'm very thankful. For Thanksgiving, and I will say I'm very thankful for you guys inviting me today. I really am. This was, I didn't know what to expect. You guys are amazing guys, and I know you. I know you're an amazing person. Very nice meeting you, and it was fun. And again, what I like is I think we align on a lot of different things.
Sure.
And I think that's important.
Absolutely.
Well, let's do some good work together, Matt.
Let's do it.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Thank you so much for being here in our digital barbershop with us.
I love it.
Yeah.
I love this place.
And to our clients, if you're living your life and you have your health, you're the wealthiest person in the world. Thanks for being here. We'll see you again soon.